My name is Rocco Caruso, and I am the producer of the film Three Backyards.
And I'm Eric Mendelson, and I'm the writer and director of Three Backyards, and it plays tonight at the festival.
Eric and I have worked together. This is the second feature that we've done, but we've also done short films, and we made films in college, and that's how we met. And we've made this film, we shot this film about 2 years ago, September of 2008, and it took us about a year to edit the film, and we only finished it this past January, and Eric can talk a little bit more about the script and how that happened, or maybe not.
It's very difficult to get a film made in America. It's basically, since my first feature film, I've been trying to get another film made. It's very difficult. We have no help from the government whatsoever. There's no grants. There's no agency with any kind of money whatsoever. So every time you make an independent film in America, maybe once in everybody's life they decide to buy a house. They ask their parents, and their parents give as much as they can. Maybe they ask their friends, but that's it. Then you don't go to anybody for any help for many years, if ever again. But if you want to be a filmmaker, you have to buy a house every so often. You have to go broke every so often. In America, the quality of films and the idea of assuring that films aren't linked inseparably to money is not an idea anyone cares about. So there are foundations that supply what they call fine arts, which are painting and ballet and sculpture, with money. But film is not considered a fine art. In fact, when you get the New York Times on the weekend, they have a section called fine arts. And then another one that says movies. And movies, it's not an art form. So it takes a long time. If you want to do a film that is outside of Hollywood, and even outside of what's interesting or conventional in the indie world, you really have to do it yourself.
Because what you end up doing is, you know, after we made our first feature, you know, we have other scripts, and you go to companies and they do, you know, it's a fairly common thing where you develop it. And so you'll get with a company and they'll say, we want to make this new film. And you will spend 2 years, 3 years working on the script, developing it. And then usually what happens is the people at that company leave, go somewhere else, and then the new people, they want to bring their own films in. So all those films in development get thrown out the window. Into the garbage.
You have wonderful suggestions. Like you say, my film is about a woman who works for the sanitation department, and she's a filth-ridden subway dweller. And they say, great, let's try for Julia Roberts. And so if you make your own films, you make your own path. I made a film that was black and white, and I was told in no uncertain terms by the premier company that distributes art films in America, not black and white. No one will watch that. So it's very limited. And the thing is, you have to remember, making films is a privilege. It's if you can afford to take the time to be in an art form like this, you shouldn't complain. It's no matter how much of a struggle it is, there's people who have it a lot worse, and this is a pleasure.
It's like that in the U.S. I mean, you could have films that are at Cannes, win Cannes, and they'll never, for one of the American people will never know about it, and that film will never get distributed, and if it does, it's a tiny distribution for
like
a week.
A few weeks, year after.
American adults are preoccupied and obsessed with Spider-Man.
Well. That was 10 years ago now, or something else.
That's what they talk about, that's what they're interested in. They're adults, and they want to see comic books. I don't want to sound artsy-fartsy. You know this expression?
No.
Artsy-fartsy means someone who talks about art with a beret on and smokes. And
okay.
But I was very interested. I believe films should be made like architecture.
Mm-hmm.
Rigorous, planned. But the inspiration for them, in America anyway, the inspiration for films is so tedious, so boring, so obvious, that when I had an idea like, this should look like a prism. You know what a prism is?
Mm-hmm.
You know, light
yeah.
and twirls around.
Okay.
And I didn't question it. I said it should feel, the film, I wanted to feel transparent. A lot of the things that occur in the film over the course of the day, people, at the beginning of the film, people know who they are. And at the end
mm-hmm.
of the film, they don't know who they are so much. And to me, that felt like everything was a little bit insubstantial.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was transparent and movable and changeable.
Yeah.
And I wanted the movie to reflect
mm-hmm.
that as well.
And the light was one of the main
yeah.
aspects.
Yeah.
Because it changes.
It changes.
Many times.
Yes, and the not only the light, but I wanted the feeling of transparency, like you could move through walls and go inside. And also, I think it's fun, the stories in the film are somewhat dark, and I love the contrast of all these people going through their little problems during the day against the brilliant sunshine. It makes
yeah.
sense. It's
yeah.
whenever you're in trouble, it's a sunny day.
Yeah.
These are all characters that I understand and people who I wrote about, and it's difficult. Maybe you're asking, there's not a lot of dialogue in the film, or people don't reveal themselves
yeah.
through dialogue,
yeah.
but they reveal themselves through action,
yeah.
Which is my favorite thing in the world. And these were all people who, the actors that I had to work with are
yeah,
the best.
Yeah.
And so they are looking for scripts where they said to me, is this what I think?
Okay.
Is she as strange as I think? I said, yes. And and so they need very little help. But those are the, also casting a film is almost a way of writing a film. So when you cast the perfect person in the film, it's like writing it well, because you don't have to do much more.
I've liked working with Eric. I like the way that he sees things. And it just, it's the kind of films that I like. You know, I even though I grew up in America, I kind of grew up on Italian and French films. That was sort of what I saw all the time. And so, what Eric was writing, it just seemed in that same, not that they were, you know, he wasn't writing foreign films, but it kind of got at the same things that I you know, loved about the great Italian and French films.
You know, there was one film, there were many films that I had the entire crew watch, but one film that became almost a joke because I had, everyone had to see the opening of The Garden of the Finzi Continis. Yeah, I don't know, how do you say it in Italian?
Giardino dei Finzi Contini.
Oh, Giardino di Finzi Continis. The beginning of the film, you know the film? The beginning is unlike anything in cinema. It's out of style now.
Mm-hmm.
But that's
out of style.
No, but I don't mean nothing good. You know, when something has an essential reason, it never goes out of style. And that film, the beginning of that film and the entry into the garden of the Finzi Continis, the bicycle trip, the mixture of handheld camera and zooms is perfect. And it's the almost everything I did in the film is stolen directly from De Sica's opening of that film.
Yeah.
I wanted, when I wrote this, I made a little test for myself, which was, using what seemed like the littlest amount of plot, could I turn
mm-hmm.
and push the biggest mountain?
Oh, no.
So, seemingly, there is very little plot. Someone has to drive someone to the boat.
Yeah.
a man misses a plane, a girl steals jewelry, and I tested myself to see if I could take that and like and push enormous mountains mm-hmm. of plot with it. And so I was very happy because in my first film, the plot was too weak for my taste now. Mm-hmm. And so this was like a little exam for me. And, you know, the performers I was using, these are people, I don't know if you're from France?
No, but I know French cinema, French culture.
In America, you know, Edie Falco, I don't know if she's known mm-hmm. here. Edie Falco is one of the best actresses yeah. in the country, and she just won the Emmy last week. And so I get to benefit from that. Yeah. You know, Elias Koteas works with Terrence Malick and Martin Scorsese, and so the idea that I get to have him on my film, it makes life very easy. Directors only get to make a few movies, and actors make so many.
Yeah.
You just trust them because they know. At one point, I had a different idea of where the scene went from
mm-hmm.
Edie, and she said, "No, I wouldn't do that." And I said, "No, I think you do." We were on the
mm-hmm.
set. I said, "No, I think you should be angrier here." And
mm-hmm.
I let her do it her way, and thank God, because what I realized in the edit room is if they're a great performer, they carry the whole movie in their head.
Mm-hmm.
You, as a director, you're carrying her performance,
yeah.
the shots, all the technical problems, all the producing, what the weather is like. The actor is like a pot that carries only one thing, the performance, and so I should trust them all the time when they're good.
No, this is actually the second time that we've won the same
yeah.
prize. Eric won the directing award for Judy Berlin, and we won it here. And it doesn't really change anything. What it does do, you make these films. Hopefully, we'll make another one.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, it's not that it validates the film,
mm-hmm.
but it's now part of the history of the festival, in that. You know, of the 4,000 films that were submitted, 16 films got into the competition, and those 16 films won't be remembered as even having been in Sundance,
yeah.
but at least our this film will be in part of the history of the festival.
I have a different opinion.
It doesn't change. It doesn't mean more money. It just, it's
not more money, but maybe the possibility to do things.
Yeah, I mean, it gives you when you're talking, money people every day are barraged by filmmakers wanting money. So when we have a new script, it's to say we've won two directing awards at Sundance.
Yeah.
So it gives you a position above, people say, oh, I'll read it because, all right, well, you've actually made films that have won awards. So, I mean, that's what's nice about it and what we'll use the award for.
I use it to keep my door propped open at home because it stays right there on the floor. The truth of the matter is, who cares? Nobody, who won last year? Do you remember who won Best Director?
I remember you. Because you're here.
Because I'm so handsome, of course.
But he can be negative, but it is,
It is, in truth, in 100 years from now, the world will look and find whatever they will find about this period that was important, and none of our opinions meant anything. It's very difficult to say. I think that there's probably interesting films being made now somewhere, but they're probably not getting into Sundance, and they're not winning directing awards. At all the big festivals that I've ever been at, all you do is worry about whether you're important or not, and no one talks about film. Nobody talks about film, I promise you. All they do is they sit and talk about a deal for Italian television that has sexy women in it. And I mean, it's ridiculous. This is, so far, I've only been here 2 days. People talk about films. People are interested in filmmaking. It's very refreshing in, to be here.
And I'll just have the one thing that was nice, you know, before even coming to the festival, you know, you apply to a lot of festivals and a lot of times you know someone at the festival, and you know there's always the need of like, are the actors going to be able to come to the festival before mm-hmm. they'll consider the film, and mm-hmm. and so it was just very nice when in my email box one day this email from Alice showed up from the Milan Film Festival, who I didn't know and had not been to Milan Film Festival before, with such excitement of like, we want your film to be here, that it was just, you know, so nice to like, someone wanted the film that I didn't call and say, oh, I've got so-and-so's in the film and they'll guarantee they will come if you let us in. So that was that, from the very beginning, that was just such a nice, and then when you invited us to come here, it's like, who can say no? And it's, you know, and
I had lasagna in Italy today for the first time ever. It was great.